Turn in your Bibles to Psalm 100. We have guys come in to preach, and we just had two guys in to preach, and we evaluate them to see if they can come into our training. We just had two guys on Friday, and I've got the clock on them. I want to see how fast they get us into God's Word. So, I was under 5 seconds, and that is awesome. Makes me so happy that I can go back and report that. It is great to be here. I do feel connected to you guys for all the reasons that Ryan said. I've been just amazed to watch what God has done through your pastor and Holly, and to see what you are in today. Can I just please go on record as saying this is the vibiest Harvest Bible Chapel I have ever been in. Unbelievable. I love this place. This is so me. So, Ryan, should you ever leave here, I'll be your replacement, okay? This is too cool. I love this place. And hanging out with Taylor, I remember when Taylor sat in my office for the first time, and we were thinking about recruiting him into the first worship class, and Taylor's sitting there, and I'm learning a little bit about he, and he was going to be marrying Jordan just after they both graduated. I think a week after they graduated, they were going to get married. I'm like, really? And then he was going to come straight into the training thing. And then he mentioned that they were from Des Moines. And I went, what? I said, did you know we're planting a church in Des Moines? I just sat by a guy who's planting the church in Des Moines for 4 months. Did you know that we're doing that? And he's like, no. And God just allowed that to come together. And man, just to see what God has done through the ministry of both of these men and their families. And so proud of them, proud of you, love you. And then John and Sarah. John and I got to hang out a few days while he was in Elgin, and went to lunch, and I gave him all of my eschatological knowledge, and so he is either well-equipped or poorly equipped, one or the other, not exactly sure, but so it was fun hanging out, and I'm just excited to see what God's going to do. Like, thanks for treading water here, and I'm sure you were learning some stuff too, but it's like, we really need to go to where God has placed us. And that's what they're going to do. And they've put it all on the line. Listen, I admire this guy. I admire these, because they have uprooted family. And they said, we will go where you want us to go, dear Lord. Amen. Over mountain or plain or sea, right? We will go. And they're going to put in it all on the line. This is all on the line, people. Okay? This is what it looks like. And so pray for them. For all those things that Sarah mentioned, pray for them. And don't let that slide in your prayer life, because they need that. They need the covering. They need that support. And God's going to do some awesome things. Amen. So, Psalm 100. Now, all of those things are great that Ryan mentioned about me, but can I tell you that my greatest claim to fame is that I'm a husband, a father, and a grandfather. Okay, those are my greatest things. I appreciate the trophies that God has allowed me to accumulate over the years of ministry, but those are the greatest things. We have kids that live in England, our son, daughter-in-law, and our youngest grandbaby, and we were with them over Christmas in England, Nottingham, England, home of Robin Hood. And we were hanging out with those guys for a week, and that was just amazing time that we had with them. We have our oldest daughter, her husband, and our two older grandkids live in Warner Robins, Georgia, and so we got to be with them in October and celebrate our granddaughter's 9th birthday. And listen, in both instances, we just spent an unseemly amount of money on those kids and grandkids. Not ashamed. I am not ashamed of that. I am proud to do that. If I had more money, I would have spent more money on them. Why? Because I love them so much, right? And I don't get to be with them that much. And so it's as a parent and a grandparent, you just want to shower them with blessings. And I'm not embarrassed about it. They're worth it. I love the Lord too. In fact, I love the Lord greater. And I'm not ashamed of him. And I would tell you that that's not always been true in my walk. I know growing up, I was just kind of back and forth and you know, wishy-washy, and there would be probably opportunities to talk about the Lord, and I wouldn't do it, and I was a little embarrassed, and you know what I'm talking about? Anybody been there? Anybody done that? Okay? But that's not the way God wants us to live. He wants us to be unashamed. In fact, Jesus said in Mark chapter 8, he said, if you are ashamed of me, in this adulterous and sinful generation. I will be ashamed of you when I come. And I just don't want to be on that end of that equation. Do you? Anybody? Because that's a bad place to be. And since we don't want to be ashamed, it means we need to live unashamed, right? And so Pastor Ryan said, hey, can you come and speak on unashamed adoration, one of the pillars of our church? You know, Pastor James wrote those pillars down long before he ever became the pastor of Harvest Bible Chapel. Did you know that? He was the singles ministry pastor at Arlington Heights E-Free Church, and he wrote down, if I ever planted a church, if I ever had a church, it would be founded on these things. These are the pillars. We're founded on Jesus Christ, but we have pillars that support our church. Preaching, worship, prayer, evangelism, those are our pillars. And so somehow over the years, I mean, we just used to call it worship. I don't know when the names all changed. I wasn't paying attention because, well, I'm a worship guy and, you know, we don't pay attention to a lot of things. But unashamed adoration, that's how we should be doing this. And I enjoyed being in the service with you and the songs that Taylor led us in. I mean, oh my goodness, those were just like he just read my sermon. The words that were coming out and the adoration that was happening. I turned around. I was sneaking a peek. How's it going? You guys are doing awesome. Appreciate the fact that you were here on time, ready to go. Thank you for doing that and being that way. So Psalm 100, David, or the psalmist, is laying out for us. I love the imagery he uses. He takes the temple. If you know anything about the temple grounds, there's the temple and there's the courtyard outside and there's the wall all around it. And there's these multiple gates that you go through to get into the courtyard. And then you're in the outer court and you go to the inner court. And eventually, if you were the high priest, once a year, you got to go into the Holy of Holies, into the very presence of God. Jesus Christ came, gave his life, and the moment that he died, God said, enough of this veil nonsense. Amen. And he ripped it open, and he said, I want to be with you, and I don't want anything in between us anymore. Amen. And so we have the opportunity to come into his presence. And so the psalmist lays out for us just how we might progress into what is unashamed adoration. So Psalm 100, you guys ready to dive in? Great, can I pray? Let me do that. Lord, I love you. Thank you so much for today and the opportunity to be here. God, I am so blessed to be here with these people. Thank you for their hearts and their lives. Thank you for their support of their pastor, God. Thank you for the prayers that we've been able to offer up for the feasts. God, just thank you for your presence. And I pray that we will honor you. You know, that's what I want more than anything. Not really interested in what I have to say, only interested in you and your word. And I pray that that will be true today, that you will speak to us and change our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, Psalm 100. The ushers, did you? Anybody not have a Bible? If you don't have a Bible, the ushers will give you a Bible. And I looked it up. Psalm 100 is on page 427 in that Bible, okay? I'm just trying to cover the details. You know what I'm saying? Okay, great. Psalm 100. This is, I don't want to set you up for failure, but I would so love to hear some response to this. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Okay, that was, thank you for doing that. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. First thing I see here, unashamed adoration, first point is, begins with thanksgiving. Begins with thanksgiving. Verse 4, enter his gates with thanksgiving. My pastor has a wonderful saying that I love to steal things from my pastor. I am not a smart guy. My pastor is brilliant. And I want you to feel free to steal things from your pastor as you are talking to people, all right? He says, gratitude is the attitude that sets the altitude for living. Gratitude is the attitude that sets the altitude for living. We need to be grateful. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 18 says, in everything, what? Give thanks. In everything. Now listen, there's a distinction here. It's not for everything. It's in everything. It really means from the inside, from within. Inside of everything I'm going through, no matter what that circumstance is, I should be giving thanks to the Lord. I think I wrote down some words. I don't know what you guys have here, but I wrote down some words when I think of Thanksgiving. First of all, it's just a recognition that something has occurred outside of me. Pastor Ryan, thank you for inviting me to come and be a part of this service today. If you had not invited me, I would have not had the permission to come, correct? So, I mean, like, I couldn't have done that. Can you imagine? I just show up. Hey, I'm going to preach today. That would have, like, not happened, right? And because something happened outside of me. Someone else gave me that invitation. And so I'm full of gratitude for you. Thanksgiving means that something happened that wasn't my decision. It's also humility. Like, I am under Ryan's authority today. I am under his authority. He is the pastor, the shepherd of this flock. And he said, would you come in and share with my people? Yes, I will, and really glad to do that. Amen. But it's humbling for that to be true, that he would allow me to come and speak with you today. Thanksgiving is an act of humility. Thanksgiving is also submissiveness in the same way that I am just putting myself under his authority. Listen, when we offer up thanksgiving to God, we are saying, God, I recognize you're in control of my stuff, and it's happening outside of me. I couldn't do this, but I'm grateful to you that you are going before me and you are opening up the path in my way, and you have provided this blessing to me. Do you see that? It's awesome. Our hearts should be filled with gratitude. I was speaking with a worship pastor just a few days ago, and they're going through some stuff. Their pastor is thinking about retiring because of some health issues, but he's kind of back and forth, and I can understand that. It's really hard to let that go, right? And so, but the staff is feeling a little bit of the weight of the indecision. And so he was just confessing to me that, hey, we're praying about that and lifting that up before the Lord. And I said, well, that's awesome. I love that you're praying about that. But can I ask you this? Are you thankful for the things that are going right? Is that coming out of your heart? Is you as a staff, have you actually just said, God, thank you for the opportunity to do ministry in this place? And he was like, you know, we haven't really talked about that. I said, well, can I encourage you to just do that? Pray for the stuff that's wrong, absolutely. But be thankful for the things that are right. And if you will do that, I just feel like God's going to respond to that in such a great way. Can I tell you, how do I be more thankful? Thanks for asking. Here's how I do it. I have Thanksgiving Thursdays. This is just how I do it. Okay, you pick your own way. I'm just throwing something out that you can go with, right? Thanksgiving Thursdays, my normal routine is whatever time I have to leave the house, whatever that time is, I wake up 2 hours early. I go down. The dog sleeps on the bed with us. He jumps down. We go downstairs. I feed him, let him out. I make a cup of coffee, go back up to my study, and then I pray 15, 20 minutes, and then I read God's word an hour or so, and then I jump in the shower and I go. That's my routine, 6 days a week. But on Thursdays, I don't pray and ask God for anything. It's Thanksgiving Thursday. And I start running down my list of things to be thankful for. God, thank you for loving me and for choosing me and for using me in ministry and to further your word and your kingdom. Thank you for doing that for me. Thank you for Jesus Christ who came and who lived his life sinless and died for me that I could have a relationship with you and that I might live forever. And thank you for the Holy Spirit who dwells in me and helps me stay on the path. And I just go down all kinds of health and family and all. I just thank you, thank you, thank you. That's what I do. And all during the day, can I tell you? Because needs will pop up during the day that you want to pray for. It's so tempting. And I'm like, nope, nope, not up, nope, thank you, Lord. I just start going down some thank yous again. It's not that I don't want to pray for those needs. I believe God's got all that figured out. That's great. I write that stuff down. I'm going to pray for that tomorrow. And I will. But Thanksgiving Thursday, that's how I do it. Why? Because gratitude is the attitude that sets the altitude for living, because God said in everything we should give thanks. And because here's the word, unashamed adoration begins with thanksgiving. You want to be there? You want to go through the gates? Let's go through the gates together. Let's do that. But I don't want to stay just at the gate. That's like, I don't know, that's plan Z, okay? I want to go further than the gate, don't you? I want to. So what's the next step? That's great. Thanks for asking, because in Psalm 104, it says this. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with? Praise. Come on, say it again.
Praise.
Yeah, praise. Praise, right. I want to get closer. That's awesome. Great. I just came through the gate. That was thanksgiving. Thank you, Lord. Now, praise. Praise is we say we're giving glory to God, right? We're ascribing worth. Now, first of all, let us not assume for one moment that we can give anything to God. You cannot add glory to God. God has all the glory. It is his. Yes? Right. So we're not, oh, God, let me add a piece of glory to you today. It's not happening that way. Right? But we are ascribing, we are acknowledging who he is. Listen, when we do Thanksgiving, Thanksgiving still has us in mind. Right? God, thank you for blessing me. Thank you for answering my prayer. Right? There's a lot of me happening in Thanksgiving, right? But when you're talking about praise, you're talking about, that's like direct at God. That is only involving him. I love the words that we sang up here today. We were singing words right from the Bible. Did you guys know that? Man, I'm telling you, Revelation chapter 5 was jumping off the screen today. It's insane. In two songs, we had that happening. And the words coming right out of the Bible, I love that. I use the words when I'm offering praise, I use words from Revelation chapter 4. Like, hey, if it's in the Bible, they must be pretty good words to use. Right? If they're saying it in the throne room of heaven, I'm thinking that's a good script. Amen. Right? Like, making up my own words seems kind of pointless. I'm just going to go with what they've got. I mean, they're writing God's presence, right? So it's awesome. Revelation chapter 4, let's praise the Lord. You see the creatures, the seraphim are there, and they never cease to stop saying, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and who is and who is to come. And they're just saying that and saying that and saying that. That's part of my prayer every 6 days a week. Well, actually 7 days a week. I do that too on Thanksgiving Thursdays. And then it says that the elders are like, they're like, ah! And they fall down on their knees and they cast their crowns before the Lord. And they're going, worthy are you to receive all glory, honor, power, and praise. You created everything. And for your glory, it's created. And I just use those words too. I love the picture of praise that is happening. And that should be part of our life as well. That's unashamed adoration. You go, well, I'm not sure, the praise thing. I don't know that sometimes I just feel like I run out of words. Read Psalms and just read it out loud, right? That's awesome. Like, how about the song? Anybody know the song Doxology? Okay, I grew up old. Before, I mean, this was like This was almost like the chorus in the hymn book. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Don't forget the last part. Amen. Oh. Hey, if you don't know what to praise, there's a list of things right there. How about praise the Father, Yahweh, Jehovah? His name is not Allah, by the way. I'm going to say that one more time. I do not want, his name is not Allah. His name is Yahweh, Jehovah. It's important you know his name because he is really jealous of his name. And you should worship him, his name. And don't be caught off by other people that would tell you something else. We should be praising God the Father, Yahweh, lifting up your voice to him. Praise Father, praise Son, Jesus Christ. I love that. We were singing about every knee will bow. Every knee is going to bow before Jesus. Did you know Philippians chapter 2? Every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Amen. Listen, if you do that now in this lifetime and make him the Lord of your life, you get to be part of the first resurrection should you go to sleep. Amen. Or if you're alive, you get to be part of the rapture and the resurrection. Hey, we're going to heaven. It's awesome. Why? Because I made him the Lord of my life today. Amen. But if you don't, you will be part of the second resurrection. And you will stand in front of the throne. And you will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. You will, because the Bible tells us that every knee, every tongue will. But your fate is not so awesome because as soon as you do that, then you are thrown into the lake of fire. That's Revelation chapter 20, verse 15. You're going to confess that he's Lord. Why don't you do it today? Why don't you do it now? Why wait? As my pastor says, why roll the dice on that one? Don't wait. This is your day. This is the day. Pastor Ryan will be standing right, like he'll come here. They'll come. Listen, we would love nothing more than for you to make Jesus Christ the Lord of your life today. Amen. Would you do that? If that's not what you've done, would you please do that? Praise Father, praise Son, praise Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit. I love him. I love the work that he does in me. He draws unbelievers to, if you're feeling that call right there, that's the Holy Spirit working in you. That's his job. He's trying to draw you in. I love that. And then for the believer, if you're like me, you don't live a perfect life. Anybody? Don't leave me hanging. Anybody? And the Holy Spirit works so hard that when you make that mistake, he's like, course correction, back here, come on. That's his job. Praise Father, praise Son, praise the Holy Spirit. Because that's just a few things you could, man, there's so much that we could praise. But here's what I want to ask is praise in your heart. Because the Bible tells us that out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Now, normally, I think we kind of use that in a negative connotation. At least, that seems to be mine. Like, oh, he's saying those bad things out of the abundance of the heart. That means he has a bad heart. But there's also the good of that. Out of the abundance of the heart. I went parasailing. Anybody ever been parasailing? You know what it is? You know, you get the parachute behind you and you're on a boat and they fly up in the air. And I did that a few years ago. and floating up and floating. It's so peaceful. If you've never done it, you should just do it. It is not scary. It's like one of the most peaceful things you could ever do. It's like rapture practice. I mean, come on. You're just floating up. It is awesome. And you get up there and you're like 100 feet in the air. And I'm just like looking out over the water and it's so peaceful and quiet. And I'm just like, holy, holy, holy. I just started singing at the top of my lungs. Why? Because it's just flowing out of me. I want it flowing out of you. Unashamed adoration begins with thanksgiving, but it brings me closer with praise. And while close is really awesome, there's something even better. And that's the third point. It's that it brings me into his presence with singing. Brings me into it. Look at verse 2. Come into his presence with singing. Oh, I love singing. I think everybody should be singing. We lift our voices in worship, and sometimes we don't know what to say, and people write songs that bless us, and we're able to do it. Did you know that God actually sings over you? Did you know? Zephaniah 3:17. I mean, come on. What is a sermon without an obscure reference to an Old Testament prophet that nobody can find in the Bible? Right? Zephaniah 3:17, it says, the Lord sings over you, check this out, with loud singing. Write it down, go look it up. He sings over you with loud singing. Why do we think that it's not so hot for us to do that back to him? Right? Why aren't we doing that? He's singing over me with loud singing. I think I should be giving that back to him. People make excuses for why they don't sing out loud. I just wrote down some of them. One is, I'm shy. Now, obviously, shy is not my issue. But people are shy. I don't lift my voice for anything. I'm just so quiet. You never know I'm there. And so I don't lift my voice. And, you know, I think God sees my heart. Yes, God does see your heart. I agree with that. But why not jump out of your shell a little bit for the Lord? Do you get excited at a ball game? You ever do that? No. Listen, you should exert yourself. You should come out of your shell for the Lord, not for us, for the Lord. Some people say, I'm shy. Other people say, I have a bad voice. Yes. Yes. But you can still lift your voice loudly for the Lord. I had a guy, one of my favorite guys in the world. I won't tell you his name. You'll run into him one day and tell the story, and then I'll be in trouble. But he wanted to sing in the choir. And so we put him in the choir, and we aimed the microphones far away from him. But he was one of the loudest singers, and he just, oh, and he just sing, and you see it on his face, and he just singing. And he made me smile every time because I knew he was singing to the Lord. Amen. Some people say, others aren't singing. I looked around, you know, the other people weren't singing, so I didn't want to stand out. My mom had a really good thing about that. When I would say, everyone else. Well, you got it? You know where I'm going? Well, if everyone else jumped off the bridge, would you do it too? You know, and then of course you get snotty. And, yes! Doesn't matter what other people are doing. Doesn't matter. You're not worshiping them. You're worshiping God. And if you're the only voice that's singing in this worship center on a Sunday morning, you should be doing it and to make up for all the ones that aren't. Amen. Well, it's a bad key. I mean, sometimes I'm singing like this.
And sometimes I feel like I need to sing like that.
And I really don't know. Sing the ones you can. Okay? Sing the words you can. Sing the notes you can. And then write a note to Taylor about the ones you can't. Oh my gosh, I've seen those notes, let me tell you. Don't let that stand in your way. Finally, somebody say, well, I don't know the song. I don't know the song. Okay, here we go. Practical application. Here's what I want you to do. Take one song a week. One song a week that you don't know. Look it up, Google it, ask Taylor to send it to you, whatever. Get the words. Like, what's the YouTube thing? Where can I find the music? And so forth, right? Type out the words. Put it on your refrigerator. Put it on your bathroom mirror. Laminate it. Put it in the shower. Everybody sounds great in the shower. Sing that song. Have it playing in your car. One song. Just one. Well, I'll get tired of it. No, learn it first. Then you can get tired of it. Okay? You're singing in the car. Sing, sing, sing. You have not lived until you've been at a stoplight singing at the top of your lungs. Open up the heavens. We want to see you. People are looking at you. Unashamed adoration. Do you feel it? I mean, do that. Learn that song. And when you come back next week, Taylor's not going to sing the same song. But eventually he'll get around to that one. And when that one shows up in a few weeks, you'll be like, I know that one. And you sing it out. And every week, take one song, learn the song, spend a week in that song. Let it bless you. Let it run through you. Let it be your voice and your words to the Lord that week. Because unashamed adoration begins with thanksgiving. It draws me closer with praise. But I can come into his presence with singing. I feel like we should really learn how to approach our Sundays in a stronger way than maybe we do. And maybe you have it figured out, and I'm preaching to the choir, and if I am, awesome. I would encourage you, parents, grandparents, Saturday nights, spend some time with your kids giving thanks. Now, should you ever have a Saturday night service, you're going to have to go to Saturday afternoons with that. But spend some time. What are we thankful for? Now, I'm a bit of a rebel, and I try to use that in the most godliest term possible. And I'm not into, you know, at Thanksgiving, that awkward moment when somebody says, let's go around the table and give thanks to God for, I'll be thankful when this is over. But spend some time with your kids. What are we thankful for? What are we thanking God for? Let's do that. Let's spend our Saturday nights that way as we get ready for bed and we think about the service tomorrow. Are you thinking about the day of the Lord? Are you preparing for that? What if we did that and really focused our hearts on Thanksgiving that night and went to bed grateful for what God is doing? And then we get up on Sunday morning and we put on some praise music in our house. No, we're not watching cartoons on the iPad. We're going to focus on the Lord. How about we give our kids a chance to really become the worshipers that God wants them to be? And we don't let the worldly stuff get in the way. Now, I know that's going to take some time. I don't expect that to happen overnight. I certainly don't. But can you begin to train your children that way? Because it's going to be training you that way too. And so we are just praise. Praise God. We read a psalm. We do something. It's praise music. It's going. And then we come in here and we drop our kids off. Or we come in the worship center before the Taylor begins the music. And we're sitting in our seats. And we're just, I praise God from whom all blessings flow. And I read a psalm and I'm getting my heart prepared. And then the music begins. And we stand to our feet. And we have already been engaged in unashamed adoration because we began with thanksgiving. And we got closer with praise, and now, bam, we come into his presence with singing. And we join the worship that is happening in heaven all the time. And we become a part of that. Together, this body of believers, this family that God has called us to. And we lift up our voices and we sing words right from the Bible. Listen, we need to have that focused attention when we come to church on Sunday morning. We need that. This should not be just a half-hearted exercise for you. You need to be fully engaged in it. We need to be less concerned with what other people are thinking. That seems to dominate a lot of us, right? Like, and so we get concerned, but shouldn't we be more concerned? Shouldn't we be more concerned about what God wants than about what other people want? Shouldn't we? Can I tell you what God wants? God wants you to lift your voice. He wants you to sing out to him with loud singing. He wants you to lift your hands. He wants you to clap your hands. He wants you to make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. That's what he wants from you. That's why he has brought you together, that we would do that together and lift up praise to the one, the only one who deserves it. That's what he's looking for. Let's be less concerned with the others, what they think. And let's focus in on the Lord. Why? Because unashamed adoration begins with thanksgiving. It brings me closer with praise. And I come into his presence with singing.